Hello and welcome to this video lecture series on digital communication. In this video, we are going to discuss FSK, which is frequency shift key. So we'll begin our discussion with a basic introduction about FSK. Then we'll discuss the mathematical part of FSK. Then we'll discuss the transmitter block diagram. Then we'll come to the receiver block diagram, and at last we'll see the constellation diagram of FSK. So let's begin our discussion with the definition of FSK. So according to the definition, the frequency of the carrier signal is changed in accordance to the message signal. So, when the message signal is changed, at that time the frequency of the carrier is also changed. So, let's see this thing with the help of an example. So, I'll take an example. So, this is my bit duration, which is TB. So, now this is my message signal, which is digital message signal 10110001. So now if I represent this digital signal with the help of line encoding, and I make the unipolar NRZ line encoding technique. So according to unipolar NRZ, 1 is represented by 1 and 0 is represented by 0. So here I am taking a generalized case where I am taking the positive voltage to be plus 1. So, when I have this signal, I can represent it with the help of plus 1 and 0. So, now I have a carrier signal. So, in frequency modulation scheme, I'll take two carriers. So, first carrier is having high frequency and the second carrier is having low frequency. So, this is my high frequency carrier and I represented it with cos omega h t. Now coming to the low frequency carrier. So this is my low frequency carrier. So I'll represent it with cos omega l t. So now coming to the frequency modulation. So when I modulate these carriers according to my data, so at that time I can have a projection scheme where 1 is represented by high frequency carrier and 0 is represented by low frequency carrier. How we'll achieve this, we'll discuss later. But let's suppose here 1 is represented by high frequency carrier and 0 is represented by low frequency carrier. So wherever I have 1, I'll represent it with high frequency, and wherever I have 0, I'll represent it with low frequency. So here I have 1, it is represented by cos omega ht, 0 by cos omega lt, 1 cos omega ht, 0 by cos omega lt, 1 by cos omega ht. So now I have this message signal which is represented by under root ps into 2, under root 2 ps. So, the message signal is represented by under root 2 ps. So, it is multiplied by cos omega ht when it is 1, and message signal is again under root 2 ps. So, amplitude is represented like this and the carrier is now cos omega l. So, at 0, the message signal is represented like this. So now this is my, when I multiply this, this is my output ST, which is the modulated output. So when signal is multiplied by the carrier, again the signal is multiplied by the carrier. So this case is for 1 and this case is for 0. So now what is happening? I can write under root 2 PS as, so I can write my under root 2 PS as PS into TB divided by TB. So TB and TB can cancel out and I left out with under root 2 PS only. So this and this are equal. I hope now you can see. Similarly, the lower carrier, lower frequency carrier are represented like this. So now from my previous video, you can watch my previous video and you can see that this function is representing an orthogonal function. Orthogonal is a function which is having a unit energy. So I represent it there, I integrated it and I show you that how this signal is having unit energy. So now this is my orthogonal function first. So I am representing it with phi 1 t. This is my orthogonal function 2. I am representing it with phi 2 t. So now my output. The output would be composed of this signal plus this signal. So my output is composed of 1 plus zeros. So at some part it has 1 and at some part it has 0. So at the output I should have the representation for 1 as well as the representation for 0. So the output ST, so this was my S1T and this was my S0T. The output ST is equal to S1T plus S0T. So output is represented like under root PSTB phi 1T plus under root PSTB phi 2T. So I can represent it as EB. So in the terms of energies, my FSK signal is represented like this. So if I make the projection on phi directions, so according to the projections on phi direction, in phi 1 direction the projection is under root EB and in phi 2 direction also the projection is under root EB. So if I have to take the distance D12, so I'll see this right angle triangle and in this right angle triangle I'll use the Pythagoras theorem. So according to the Pythagoras theorem, the hypotenuse square is the summation of the square of the sides. So D12 square is equal to under root EB square plus under root EB square. So D12 is equal to under root 2EB. So here I can see that Euclidean distance is under root 2EB. We use this Euclidean distance to find out the probability of error. So now coming to the bandwidth. So the output signal is comprised of two carriers. So it is having two carriers which are represented by the power spectral density like this. So the two carriers are having the bit duration TB, so I can represent them with the Gaussian function and the bit duration for both of them is TB. So the distance between them, the highest and lowest part of the high carrier is 2TB because this is FH plus FB and this is FH minus FB. Similarly, this is FL plus FB. This is FL minus FB. So again, this is, so the bandwidth is 2FB. So the bandwidth is 2FB plus 2FB. So bandwidth is 4FB. Now, I can see the bandwidth has increased, but with the help of Euclidean distance, in the next video, we'll see and we'll compare the probability of error of ASK, FSK and PSK. Then we'll get to know why we are choosing FSK. Plus in FSK, we don't have a DC component. So every time there is a signal. So in ASK, 0 was represented by 0 level. So if I have long stream of zeros, the long stream of zeros is represented by long 0. So if the receiver would misinterpret that the signal is not coming. So to avoid all these things, I have FSK. So now coming to the block diagram of transmitter of FSK. So this is the block diagram of the transmitter. I hope now you understand what is happening in the FSK. So first I have the message signal. So message signal is represented like this. So if this is the message signal, so message signal is going here. So at the product modulator, the message signal is multiplied by cos omega ht. So here I'll get a signal which is represented like this at 0, 1, 0. So 1 is represented by a high frequency carrier and 0 are represented by 0 signal. So this is 1, this is 0. So this is how my output is represented at this block. So now coming to the downside block. So here I have inverter. So at the inverter, 1 is converted to 0 and 0 is converted to 1. So now the after the output of inverter, I'll get 0, 1, 0, 1, 1, 0, 1. So the output is multiplied by low frequency carrier. So the output is represented like this. At first bit level, I have here 0, I have here 1. So when these two are combined at first level, I'll get this frequency. At second level, here I have frequency, here 0. So I'll get this frequency. So when I combine these two, I'll get the output which is represented like this. So this is my output. So now you can see this block diagram is working in accordance to my FSK modulation scheme. So now coming to the receiver. So this is the block diagram of my coherent receiver. In coherent receiver, I'll multiply the output modulated signal with the carriers once again. So now I have the output modulated signal. So this is my modulated signal. So this signal is fed to the bandpass filter, which is having the frequency omega h. So it is only transmitting the signal which is having the frequency omega h. So now this is this signal. So with the help of bandpass filter, I can eliminate all the low frequency components here. So the output of this bandpass filter would look like this. So now this bandpass filter is again multiplied by cos omega ht. So high frequency carrier is again multiplied with this. So after that, if I pass it through low pass filter, so I hope now you get it. I'll get A, which is the amplitude, received amplitude, multiplied by cos square omega ht. So I can represent cos square omega ht as 1 plus cos 2 omega ht upon 2. So after I expanded this. So now when I pass this signal through the low pass filter, this is my high frequency component. So this is get it rejected. The high frequency signal is rejected and I am only left with the low frequency message signal. So at the output, I am left out with A by 2. So now again, at the lower block, I have the bandpass filter with omega L. So here I'll get all the low frequency components. So this is how my output looks like. It rejects all the high frequency components from the output of ST. So when it is multiplied by cos omega LT, so similarly, I'll reject the high frequency components. Remember, here I have cos omega LT, which is low frequency. So I represent it as, so I have represented my signal like this. So after passing through low pass filter, this signal get rejected. Why? I have written it is A cos 2 omega LT upon 2. So it is also a low frequency component, but it is a low frequency component of carrier. So we'll understand this with the help of an example. So let's suppose you are walking and your speed is represented by the frequency of message signal. So your speed is the frequency of message signal. So I have two carriers now, high frequency carrier and low frequency carrier. The high frequency carrier is the speed of an airplane. So, and the low frequency carrier is the speed of a train. So if you are superimposed on high frequency carrier, your speed would increase. Similarly, if you are superimposed on low frequency carrier, that is train, your speed would again increase. So the speed of train, when it is compared with your speed, it is very high. Similarly, the frequency of low frequency carrier is much high as compared to the frequency of the message signal. So this is why this is also get it rejected. Similarly, at output of low pass filter, I am left out with A by 2. Now the comparator or the decision making device will make the decision that I have 1 or 2 based upon the level of the amplitude of A by 2. So I hope now you understood the basic functioning of the coherent receiver. Now we'll come to the phase lock loop. So now when I use the phase lock loop as a receiver, so it can be used in the case of FSK only. I have the comparator, I have the local oscillator in the feedback. So the local oscillator gives its value to the comparator, which compares and gives me the message signal. So now coming to the non-coherent receiver. So now in non-coherent receivers, I have the signal which is again passed to the band pass filter with high frequency and low frequency. So here I'll get the high frequency signal, here I'll get the low frequency signal. So now after that, it is passed to the envelope detector which is composed of rectifier plus low pass filter. So now low pass filter removes all the high frequency carrier signals and rectifier helps to detect the boundary of the signal. So rectifier is finding out the boundary, and here the boundary is on the positive side and here the boundary is on the negative side. So now the decision making device makes the decision that I am getting 1 or 0 depending upon the output of envelope detector. So here it will make the decision that is 1 or 0, and now the regenerator will regenerate the signal back. So I can say that this is how I can regenerate my signal with the help of non-coherent FSK receiver. So I'll stop my discussion here for this video. I hope you like this video. Like this video and share it with your friends if you like it. Thank you so much.